Okay, you got the show.
Okay. Okay, welcome. Usually I give a talk. I do most of our lectures. Today one of our partners is going to give most of the webinar, but I'll just do a small introduction. What we see when we look at our customers is that our customers get more and more sophisticated. When we initially started this, people just wanted to play with triples, and they were happy that they had something that they could put triples in, and they could use Prolog or SPARQL to get something out of it. And with our tool Graph, it gets makes it easier and easier for people to get data out of there. But then if you look at these customers, you see it's a wide range, and each of these customers has more and more very specialized questions. And a few of them are pharmaceuticals. We have Pfizer, with people like Lilly, Eli Lilly, GlaxoSmithKline. They're all trying out and doing advanced research and some early production with AllegroGraph. And what we see is that with most of these customers, well, initially it was just helping them with database tuning and helping a little bit with integration, but more and more they want more advanced stuff. And what we see is that we do these more advanced stuff together with some partners. So, for example, when our customers need advanced ontology building, they usually will use TopRate Composer, but TopRate Composer is integrated with AllegroGraph. If people want to do real heavy-duty owl reasoning, then they can use Razor, and if you buy a Razor license, then there will be a whole version of AllegroGraph included in that product. Real soon, we will have a data mining tool on top of AllegroGraph. We're using a Belgium company for that. It's called Pepito, and you can check out their website for what they do. Many, many of our customers actually want to take unstructured text, whether it's email or web pages or documents, and they want to put it into triples. And so we have one partner called Expert Systems, and we've built some software to actually point AllegroGraph at a text and automatically get triples in. And right now we're productizing that particular link. And then we recently have done some projects with our partner IO Informatics, and Bob will give a little introduction to that company in a few minutes. We did a project for Pfizer, and we're looking at some other projects, and they have the thing we're going to show today is that they have this wonderful tool to officially build SPARQL queries. I guess that most of you are slightly afraid to build queries like this by hand. I mean, so you have your wonderful data set, now you want to do queries, and now you've got the hell of finding the prefixes and finding the names of the predicates and then all the SPARQL syntax. And wouldn't it be just fantastic if you could do this all with a GUI? And so actually we now, with our partner, found this this tool, and in the next 20 minutes we'll demo what that tool actually can do. And please realize this already will work with AllegroGraph. So Bob, over to you.
Okay, thanks. I'm Bob Stanley. I'm the CEO of Bioinformatics. And first I'd just like to thank Franz for inviting us to co-present today. And we've really enjoyed working with Franz, and we're excited to have our Sentient software suite integrated with their latest version of AllegroGraph. So before I hand off the demo part to Kasia Kadri, who's our Director of Sales, I'll just give some real brief background on our software and also a little bit of the context of the demo. Bioinformatics Sentient Suite of software applies semantic technology and integrates files, databases, instruments, applications, and we've really been focusing in the healthcare and life science market, and we are also excited about working with Jans in a few other market places. So the software delivers enterprise technology for data exploration, visualization, and fit-for-purpose knowledge bases and targeted applications. And one of the centerpieces of this technology is the tool we'll be showing you today, the Knowledge Explorer, and its ability to generate a SPARQL from a visual interface. So as Jan's mentioned, what we're really going to be focusing on today is just showing you how easy it can be to create pretty advanced SPARQL just right off of a network. And for the demo, we'll start with some very basic examples, just using a real small public demo data set about wine. I think probably a lot of you guys may be familiar with kind of a toy data set, just to get the idea across. But after creating and modifying some simple queries, we'll move to some much more interesting queries using some real customer examples and a big set of life science data that we've integrated and have running in AllegroGraph 4.0. So before I get into a lot of detail about those life science data sets, let's just hand this off to you, Kashyap, and see how you can create some queries using that little wine data set.
Thank you, Bob. Good morning, everyone. And for those of you that might be in a different time zone, good afternoon. I wanted to start off with a light and simple example, as Bob mentioned, with this wine RDF. It's pretty early here again in the morning on the West Coast, but I'm sure it's happy hour somewhere in the world. So just looking at what you see on the screen, this is a graph view of the Sentient Knowledge Explorer. And so if I were interested in, you know, these two wines and these three qualities of these wines, meaning that it has a medium body, moderate flavor, and a dry sugar content, we could visually explore this within the Knowledge Explorer tool, but the focus of this webinar is to show how easy it is to create a visual SPARQL query. So what I'm going to do is if I knew that I liked this specific type of wine or that I liked the three qualities about it, I can just simply click on the entities that are of interest within the Knowledge Explorer application, right-click, I get this drop-down menu, and towards the bottom of that I see Create Query. And as simple as that, once I click here, it'll take me into a different window in which I have my wine of interest and the three characteristics or qualities that I'm interested in, as well as the location. So if I were, for example, interested in entertaining some guests and wanted to take them up to Sonoma, and I knew, again, that I wanted this type of wine, or I was looking for other wines with similar qualities or characteristics, I can just simply right-click and make this wine a variable and type in the word wine here. And once towards the right of the screen, you can see this Run Query button. Once I select that, this is going to search the wine ontology and return five wines that met this characteristic or these qualifications that I predetermined. The SPARQL that I generated visually is also created in text format in case you wanted to repurpose that if you wanted a copy or a paste. And the other advantage, another huge advantage of this query tool and its simplicity is if I changed my mind and I no longer wanted to go to Sonoma but wanted to go to Napa, I can also edit the SPARQL query within this box here. So like I said, if I want to change my mind and now go to Napa, I can simply delete the Sonoma in the SPARQL text here, rerun that query, and it's now going to return three different wines that still have those three qualities, but now we're in the Napa region instead of Sonoma.
Okay. So that's hopefully a simple example that gives a basic idea about how the software works to make it easy to visually create and modify SPARQL using Sentient running on AllegroGraph. This was clearly a simple example, a small data set, not something that really would be demanding a high-performance semantic database like Franz. So we're going to move on to a real-world customer example for visual query building using a big life science data set. So for a little context on this next demo, we brought several different life science data sources into a graph. We have a couple of sets of customer experimental data, and we also have subsets of several public life science databases that add up together to just about a billion triples or so. So we have a gene expression database that's customer data around toxicity. It's gene expression that is associated with a toxic insult like benzene exposure, that sort of thing. We also have metabolic data. That's information about metabolites. That's spectrometry data that's been translated to values that's associated with treatment and outcome information. So the gene data is a little less than half a billion triples, about 200 million triples on the metabolic data, and then we brought in a number of public data sources that Kashyap will point out to you as we go through the demo. That's about another quarter of a million or so triples. So it's a nice data set. We've done some publishing on this too, so you can look on our website and see some more examples of what we've done with this data. The customer's going to use this to find patterns that combine gene and metabolites to identify certain types of toxic exposures. So Kashyap's going to be sort of walking through an example of that today, visually creating SPARQL, and then showing you some pretty advanced queries that we can get out of this data set.
Thanks again. So as Bob mentioned, we're looking at two different data sets. The entities in purple are your genes. The green boxes are your metabolites. So essentially, this is looking at which genes and metabolites have been changed, significantly perturbed by these two toxicants, which are off in the top right corner and the bottom left, so the bromobenzene and the galactosamine. So essentially, this is looking at changes, looking at the genetic and chemical profiles or fingerprints in terms of changes. You see a lot of activity here. So this is just actually a very small subset of the entire data set. We've spent some time looking at the statistics to make something a little directed, but as Bob mentioned, this is part of a much larger data set that was brought in. I don't want to confuse everyone in terms of the science. I've actually got a molecular genetics background, and this kind of thing interests me. But just to point out, this could be any number of data sets within life science or outside of that, including business intelligence, inventory, manufacturing, etc. So just kind of highlighting the ease of creating a visual SPARQL query, what I'm going to do starting off is just pick two entities and kind of drag them off to the left to kind of show the simplicity. In the first example with that wine data, I selected each entity individually. This time around, I'm going to draw a box around the three entities that are interesting to me. So this is looking at one specific gene and one specific metabolite that are both affected by bromobenzene, this toxicant towards the bottom. Again, by right-clicking, I get this window, and if I scroll down to the bottom with Create Query, I go into the Query tool where I can select any one or all of these entities as variables, make them variables, and return results accordingly. So just for starters, I'm going to right-click on this toxicant, make that a variable, and what this is going to show is all treatment agents that affect these two entities. And I get two results back, which kind of confirms what I was visually exploring. Kind of taking that one step further, I can also click on this gene up towards the top left corner of your screen, make that a variable, and this is going to return all genes and all treatment agents that were significantly perturbed based on my experimental data. Again, just to point out here, the SPARQL query itself is generated here, and if you wanted to edit that or copy that again, you could do that. So one of the in terms of life science, one of the hot topics is personalized medicine, which is essentially the right treatment at the right dose for the right patient. And a significant amount of focus is around biomarkers, which are essentially creating a profile or a signature for a specific event. And one of the ways to kind of justify that, so a lot of people are spending time coming up with these molecules, combining different elements to kind of say, if these five conditions are met, this is the agent that's causing it. And one of the ways to confirm that is to look out into references that are available. And as Bob mentioned earlier, we've brought in several reference references, public references here, including, you know, Biocarta, Entree, and HMDB. These probably all seem like Greek to you, but these are pretty widely accepted public data sets that have different bits of information, including which drugs are associated or disease are associated with a set of genes or metabolites, et cetera. So what I've done here is off of this molecule LPL, I've grown out to show the enzyme as well as the pathway, which is essentially just showing the function of that specific gene. And the highlight here is that I can not only work within my data set, but go out to public references that weren't part of my original data set. And again, what I'm going to do here is just draw a box around a few of these entities of interest. I can also deselect if I drew a box too big or too large, and then right-click and create a query towards the bottom here. Now, this is interesting because now I can make this function here a variable, as well as the gene. And this is going to return all genes as well as their functions that are affected by this toxicant. And I see a decent sized list, but I see that this new column of the function is now appearing. So I can go back and validate some of my results using public data. If I wanted to also see which toxicants or treatment agents are affected by this metabolite, I could do that. And again, just simply right-click or left-click on the run query and return back not only the treatment agents and the gene, but also the treatment agent, which are listed here. Again, the SPARQL query is generated, and I could play with that if I chose to. The last thing I wanted to do here is actually load an existing query. In terms of the biomarkers, this is the sort of thing that people would be interested in, not only looking at specific entities and kind of growing out to the public domain, but also putting some restrictions. It's very easy to add in restrictions within the tool here. By right-clicking on any one or several of the entities, I can make restrictions both in terms of text as well as numerical values. So what I've done here is added some restrictions in terms of the full change. So on these five genes that are in purple across the top, I restricted them for specific full change values. And that was part of creating the biomarker signature. And what this is showing is so if I have these five genes and three metabolites in this combination, what is the toxicant? So if I was presented with a case showing exposure with these specific, you know, genes changed, at these levels, as well as a metabolite change, I could say with pretty good certainty that this was the treatment agent, and also I can make a restriction in terms of what that dose was. And again, by returning that, I get the two toxicants, the two treatment agents, as well as some of the background information. So these are the actual numerical values for those genes that met those criteria that I set.
Can you show the SPARQL query?
Sure. And right here, you can see that the SPARQL query has gotten a little longer, a little more complex in terms of what we're looking at.
Yeah. Great. Thanks. So what I'm hoping you can see here, and since we're looking at the SPARQL right now, for those of you who may be more or less experts in SPARQL, this is a great way to generate a little skeleton that then you can modify manually, and also the creation of the SPARQL visually, I think, is something that I hope everyone can see. So basically what we've done is gone over a very simple query, then bringing in a larger data set and creating a number of different SPARQL queries visually. And there's a lot more we could talk about in the Sentient Suite. I'd love to get Kashif off showing all the nice visualization and
graphing and scaling and different things we can do, but we're focusing today in the visual creation of SPARQL. And again, thanking Franz for having us over, and hope it was a useful demo.